We start tonight with the theft of part of Britain's heritage at Drumlanrig Castle, 14 miles north of Dumfries. One of the most audacious art thefts of our time. It began in Edinburgh with a Geordie answering a small ad for an old Golf GTI.
You had a bit of the car?
Hi, John.
He introduced himself as John and he had a broad Geordie accent.
Very fast, really fast.
I didn't think anything was strange at first because I just thought he was a guy just coming to buy my car. But after a while, the guy just seemed a bit shady, to be honest. We walked round and just had a look over the car.
600 for you, cash.
Oh. Make it 7, we can do a deal.
7, mm-hmm. She is fast.
Yes.
He was always asking me if the car was fast as well. About 5 minutes later, they had bought the car and that was him away. As soon as I got the money, I actually took it to the bank just to check it to make sure it was OK.
The Golf was driven south across the border to Carlisle and was probably parked up there for the week before the robbery. A couple of days before the raid, on August Bank Holiday Monday, two men were seen driving it away from J. Smith Close. Then, on the Wednesday in Thornhill, 2 miles from Drumlanrig Castle.
The day of the robbery, I was in Thornhill to collect my newspaper and visit a friend. And as I approached the main street, immediately opposite, there was a white Volkswagen parked at an unusual angle. I thought it was about to reverse, so I waited until he completed his manoeuvre. He didn't move. The traffic passed by, the road was clear, and I proceeded with my journey.
By 11 o'clock, the castle grounds were getting busy. The guides prepared for visitors, and a coach party arrived early for a guided tour.
Some days, they can have up to about 200 people each day. It was more sort of like for fun rather than an actual job. All you had to really do was talk to people, and it was quite nice.
As well as the coach party, two men had been waiting to go in. They were very aware of the closed-circuit cameras, which suggest they'd been here before. And rather than follow the visitor route, they headed straight for the staircase gallery, where there were works by Rembrandt, Holbein and Leonardo da Vinci.
I was in the morning room, and then there was visitors came in straight away. I was quite surprised they came so quick, because usually they take longer to get from the first room to the second room, because you'd expect them to kind of have a look around first.
Around the same time, another man was at the back of the castle, keeping lookout for the thieves. He was in his early 20s.
Seemed normal visitors to me. You do kind of keep looking at them the whole time just in case they want to ask something. Well, one of them was sort of looking about, another one just turned towards the door. I don't know what he was doing.
They overpowered her and took the Da Vinci off the wall. The painting, even in its frame, is small enough to fit under a coat. But with the automatic alarm ringing through the grounds, two enterprising people turned their video camera on the thieves.
Somebody from our estate office came out up the valley, and the first I knew was seeing somebody climbing up the hill and could hear a faint voice saying, "The Leonardo's being stolen." Which obviously was stunning. You read about museum gallery thefts and you see movies, and so it has an element of fantasy about it. I'm afraid the reality is pretty dreadful when it does actually strike. And of course, when it happens, it does come as a shock.
The police got to the castle quickly, but the gang had taken a back route 5 miles along country lanes to Moreton Mains, where the Golf was found abandoned. They probably switched to another vehicle, possibly a black BMW, that was seen soon after, speeding along the foothills between Carron Bridge and Mitchell Slats.
The first thing I saw was the news when I went home. It just seemed like it was happening somewhere else. It didn't seem like I was involved with it. They kind of mentioned a guide had been overpowered, and it just didn't seem like it was me.
There is a sense of horror at this very peaceful, tranquil, serene picture being wrenched away from the wall, the element of sort of personal force and violence involved. And it is just the antithesis of all that this painting stands for, of serenity and peace and tranquility.
Good evening. A dramatic theft, and as you'll hear, a dramatic reward. We're live from Studio One in Television Centre, taking your calls along with police from across the UK.
Including Chief Inspector Peter McAdam from Dumfries and Galloway Police, who's investigating the Leonardo theft. And presumably, Peter, mouths must be moving and talking on this one because so many people were involved. And this piece of art is just so hot. It's been making headlines here and across the world.
Yes, indeed, Nick. It's a particularly audacious crime. It's a very unusual MO. People must be talking, and the gang who committed this crime must be talking out with the gang. They must be talking to other people. They must be boasting about this.
Now, tell us about the reward. Procurators Fiscal don't like us telling people exactly what the reward is, but it's big, very big.
It's a substantial reward, which has been put up by the insurance underwriters.
Now, OK, we can't give the exact sum, but it is sufficient to make somebody very, very rich indeed, if they know who did this, and if they can get them prosecuted, convicted, and if you can get the art back.
Yes, indeed.
Now, you also need to know about what happened to these cars. We know the Golf, for example, the one that was bought in Edinburgh, was in Carlisle for a time. What more do you need to know?
I want to know where the Golf was the night before the crime. I want to know if the Golf was with the black BMW. Has it been parked outside somebody's house in a quiet residential street, like where they hid the Volkswagen Golf in Carlisle? Has it been at a bed and breakfast? Has it been at a rented cottage? I want to know where it was the night before the crime.
And it's possible the black BMW is actually a car that one of the thieves actually owns?
Possibly.
Descriptions? Well, of course, we've only got the description, really, of the guy, a good description, the guy who bought that GTI in Edinburgh.
That's right.
Tell us about him.
He's a male. He's 5'10" to 5'11". He has a distinctive oval-shaped face. He has sideburns, and bushy eyebrows. He looks as if he's got pointed ears. He has an earring in his left ear.
We don't know if the Geordie accent was put on or whether it was legitimate, of course. But Peter, what would people have done with this painting? There is no chance on earth that they can sell this unless they pass it off as a copy.
No, we don't think so. We think it may be used as collateral in a drugs transaction, an arms transaction, or something like that. But really, it's not worth anything like its value on the black market.
Well, if there's any way that you can identify anything, if you want to get your hands on that reward, call us or call the Instant Room. And you can reach Peter McAdam through this number, 01387 252 112. Now, that's really important if you want to claim the reward, because you will possibly want to remain anonymous. So call the Instant Room number if you want to do that. And you can also contact us by email through our website. That's bbc.co.uk/crime.
In a moment, extraordinary town centre CCTV as police close in on an abductor.
The girl who was so upset at being called a thief, she organised a robbery.
We don't have any money.
And the antiques that were discovered by police along with a dead body. Do any of these belong to you? Now, while some of us have been soaking up the summer sunshine, officers across the UK have been following up leads from our July programme. There's been good progress and a number of arrests.
In July, 20 calls came in after we reconstructed the abduction and violent attack on a 13-year-old schoolboy by a number of boys in Tottenham, North London. 7 arrests followed soon after. Police need to trace this man. It's a hazy image, but if you know who he is, call.
Clinton Anthony Frederick Williams had been charged with rape but failed to appear at his trial in May last year. A Crimewatch viewer rang in and gave police an address. That led to more information, and Clinton Williams is now in custody awaiting trial.
We also had around 20 calls from viewers after showing Justin Neal's face in July. He was the man who police wanted to trace over what they called the Dr. Plastic case, because credit cards had been stolen from hospital medical staff. Officers from Durham were about to act on information they'd received when Justin Neal handed himself in. He's now been charged with a number of deceptions and has been remanded in custody.
And now here's Detective Sergeant Jackie Haynes.
Undercover cameras catching people in the act, and not just CCTV. This first piece of footage was given to us by Cambridgeshire Constabulary and shows a drug deal as it happens. This footage was filmed as part of an operation targeting crack cocaine and heroin dealers in Peterborough. This man openly handed over crack cocaine during a daylight deal in a park in the town centre. He couldn't be arrested straight away for fear of blowing the cover of the operation, but we haven't been able to find him since. It is possible that he's left the area. Now, we think he goes by the street name Pablo or Courtney, but we haven't yet been able to find out his real identity. Can you help? Next, staying in Peterborough, who's this buying a laptop computer in the town centre back in February? We believe he was using someone else's credit card at the time. The same man was seen again 25 minutes later at the Arcadia store up the road. This time he bought several pairs of Paul Smith jeans, again not using his own credit card. We believe he may be from Coventry or somewhere else in the West Midlands. Call us if you recognise him. Notting Hill Carnival in West London, not the one just gone, but last year's event, and an attack which we're still trying to solve. Among this crowd was a French tourist dancing alone. Suddenly, a man standing nearby attacked him. The tourist was thrown to the floor, struck several times with a bottle, and had severe cuts which needed hospital treatment. Remember, this is last year, 2002's Carnival. Do you know the bottle attacker? Finally, to Wiltshire, and this man entered a grocery store in Marlborough back in May. CCTV cameras got plenty of shots of him as he wandered the aisles. He settled on a chocolate bar, but when he went to pay, he grabbed the cashier's wrist and managed to snatch cash from the till. Tell us who he is.
If you can help with any of these cases, please call us here in the studio, 0500 600 600.
Now, a serious crime that was averted, but it's so appalling, everybody's going to want to help find the offender. The way it was foiled was so dramatic that you may have seen clips of this on the news. It happened late on a Thursday night, 3 months ago, in Doncaster.
After midnight in Doncaster town centre, and the security cameras happened to spot a stocky man in Christchurch Road.
Don't you even care? Don't you bother what I think? You don't, do you? You know
that night, a mile away, a couple are having a late-night row, and their flatmate is at breaking point.
Stop reading that! Every time it's him, you say you're gonna sort it, but you don't. You never do! Will you listen? Right, does it mean nothing to you? Where do I come off?
I was going back to my mum's in Carcroft, just around about 5.5 miles from where I was leaving. I never had no money for a taxi and there weren't no buses running at that time. I'd done it before, I walked from Hyde Park to Carcroft. I just assumed because I'd done it before I could do it again.
By now, the stocky man had been walking round for 2 hours. At 3 a.m, a probationary police officer came off shift at College Road.
Right, that's me done for tonight. I'll see you tomorrow.
Mick, hi, it's Paul.
Yeah, no, I just can't keep away.
Listen, I've just driven over the new bridge and there's a young girl walking across all on her own. You couldn't advise the control room, could you, and get them to keep an eye on her?
Great. Thanks, mate, yeah. And you, good night.
Camera on, can I help you? Yes, I'm looking now. I'm going to vote on the manager, 1 second. OK, thanks, I've got that.
I noticed this bloke over the other side of the road, and I seen him walking down, but he stayed on the opposite side of the road to me. I didn't really think much of it, because it being that time in the morning, I just assumed he would go into a 24-hour garage. And I got towards crossings, and he crossed over to the same side of the road as me. And I noticed his shadow outside of me, so I moved to the side so he could walk straight past.
Not very talkative, are you? Where have you been?
Hyde Park.
Where are you going?
Carcroft.
Oh. Long walk, innit?
Yeah. Get out! Help!
I was struggling and shouting at him, telling him to get off me, because I was struggling that much, he picked me up.
Romeo 1, I'm monitoring the girl up York Road. The bloke's picked her up now, through the bushes, off York Road. Alpha Control, can you get some mobiles there, please?
What are you doing? Get out! Get out! Get out! Put him down!
I knew what he were attempting to do, but I was just panicking all I was trying to think about getting away from him.
Put me down! Put me down!
Just lowered his arms and put me down. Right. I'm not sure whether he noticed police or I was just struggling too much. You hear about these things on the news. You just think it's the kind of thing that happens to other people. But it could have been a lot worse than that.
This is DCI Richard Fuchs from South Yorkshire Police. She was very lucky with that. She really, really was. But this guy, tell us about him. He is huge. He's somebody put him as high as 6'5". He's a big, big boy.
He is a very big man. He's well built. He's stocky. He's possibly up to as tall as 6'5", and has been described as being muscular as well. But he has got a slight beer belly on him.
And he had an odd walk as well.
He's quite distinctive in the way that he walks. One of his legs, his left leg, appears to be slightly bowed, and he always walks with one of his hands in his pocket as well.
If he's watching tonight, of course, that's a habit he'll stop pretty soon. His hair, tell us about his hair too, because that's quite distinctive.
Well, his hair's quite distinctive as well. He's got very wavy hair. It's grown long at the back. It's greying, but cut very short around his ears. He's balding on the top of his head and on his forehead as well.
And he's been walking around Doncaster for so long. Were you able to tell from the pattern whether he knew that town very well or was just wandering aimlessly? Is he a local, in other words?
Well, we believe that he is an individual that has got some knowledge of Doncaster.
But not intimate, you think?
Certainly not intimate, no. We can't rule out that he's a local man, but our belief that he is an individual who's come to Doncaster, perhaps for his employment, and that's why he's actually there on that particular night.
Now, this was an abduction. It could very easily have become a rape. It could possibly have become a murder. Terribly serious. This guy might well have previous, therefore police officers might know him, a whole bunch of other people might know him as well. Might have been in prison with him.
That's right. Our specific appeal tonight is to anybody that recognises this man, particularly from the CCTV imagery, friends, relatives, work colleagues, or other people in different professions that may have come across him in the past.
OK, well, as I say, the girl was very, very lucky, and good for the rookie police officer for getting the cameras there. 0500 600 if you've any idea who this man is. Please, if we've got the names, the police can try and sort through them very easily in this case. Or you can call the incident room itself. That's on 01302 385 353.
4 months ago, police were called into a house in Cambridgeshire where they found a body. It's now the subject of a murder investigation. But in the same house, police found these. A total of 73 antiques, which police are now trying to reunite with their owners. Our antiques expert, Paul Hayes, is here with us as usual to tell us more about them. So, Paul, what grabs your eye particularly?
Some very unusual items. We start with this one here. This is a late 19th century black slate clock, Belgian slate, but it's mounted with a fabulous quality bronze. Now, this is typical of what was going on sort of 1850, 1900. Lovely quality, and there's a quality movement to go with it, so superb piece.
And if someone wants to claim this as theirs? How can they identify themselves as the genuine owner?
What we're looking for is the movement, the maker of the movement. It's quite distinctive, and I think someone would know definitely.
And how much would something like this be worth?
You're towards £1,000, sort of £800 to £1,000 for that one. Because of the bronze, that's on top of it. Fantastic.
And this is a beautiful painting here, isn't it? This is the Thames, or you see the Palace of Westminster here.
Yeah, I mean, this is wonderful. It's a 19th century watercolour. We've got the Age of Steam here going on as well. We've got this lovely sort of steamboat, we've got the sailing ships, we've got the bridge and so on in the background. A very well-known watercolour artist. This is very clearly dated 1889, so fantastic. Well over £1,000, upwards you pay about £3,000 in a gallery for that.
So the person who wants to claim this as theirs needs to know who the artist is?
Yeah, it's the artist really is what we're looking for.
Okay. Now this struck me, this this kind of sort of little figure here.
Yeah, this is absolutely amazing. This is a solid ivory figurine, dates late 19th century. It's got these solid silver fitments here. This is a breastplate. It's got his halberd, which comes across the top. It's got these four ostrich plumes. But if you come down to the bottom here, the bottom is solid silver, which has been gilded and enamelled with the interior design on the top, and it's actually inlaid with rubies. If you have a look, there's a little line of rubies down the bottom.
Yeah.
And if you look when you actually come up to the ivory body itself, these are rubies, garnets, sapphires.
Wow.
Fantastic quality.
So, and valuable,
eh? Very valuable, yes. You're looking at least £3,000, probably to about £5,000 for that figure.
And again, if someone wants to claim this as theirs?
There's some quite distinct markings on the bottom. I'm not going to give too much away.
Okay, so if you want to claim this as yours, you need to know what those markings are. Now, what about here? We've got some beautiful little pieces here, haven't we?
Yeah, we have. We start with this one. This is an 18th century tobacco box. It's gilded metal. It's got this wonderful enamel scene of a harbour on the top of it. It's actually, the base of it is solid tortoise shell, which is very unusual.
Oh, that's
for that
lovely,
period.
Isn't it?
Yeah, beautiful. But what's interesting about that one, it actually has the original exhibition. It's got some papers in the top. It was exhibited in the 1960s, not the original one, sorry, 1960 was it exhibited, and that's all detailed on that piece of paper. So what we're looking for is where it was exhibited.
Where it was exhibited.
Yeah, fantastic.
Okay. Now what about this?
This one.
Tiny, but apparently very valuable.
Yeah, I quite like this one, actually. This is a gentleman's watch fob seal. Now the idea was this would go on his watch chain, and it's actually been engraved or intaglio carved here so that it actually produces a cameo seal. When you come to seal your letters, when you place that onto the wax, it shows up in cameo. Fantastic.
And there's a different one on the other side, so...
Yeah, the idea is I had two gentlemen here, whether they've been in business together or some sort of union, so they've had to use two stamps on a particular letter. It's carved amethyst, it's solid gold, and fantastic. Dates about 1800.
So if someone wants to claim this as theirs, how are they going to do that?
There's a quite distinct hallmark on that. That's what we're looking for that one.
OK, the hallmark. OK, well... If any of these are yours, call us now, 0500 600 600. You'll need to tell us something about each of them, as we've said, that we've not disclosed here tonight, and then you can claim it as yours. Now, DS Jackie Hames is with Detective Chief Superintendent Jeremy Payne, looking at the calls that have come in so far.
Well, I have to say, it was actually a genuine feeling of excitement building up here, particularly over the painting, the Leonardo da Vinci painting stolen in Scotland. We've had some fantastic quality information coming from specialist police officers who deal with this type of investigation, which just clearly requires different skills from many others. We've had, actually, lots of names, but two the same come in already. We do need some more information on that gold between the white Golf. It was sold on the 19th. Where was it before? Before the 27th, when the offence happened. Please keep calling in.
I'm looking at a really interesting call for that attempted abduction in Doncaster. Got somebody who says that this guy who he's suggesting is an absolute dead ringer for what he's just seen on the CCTV, where he used to live, and where he works now, which is in Doncaster. So I'm really excited about that. We'll be following that one up. Now, the studio number is on the screen, and if you're watching on digital satellite TV, you can email us directly through your remote control. Just press the red button on your handset and choose Crimewatch.
Coming up, the notorious murder of two teenage girls in Edinburgh. 26 years later, there's new evidence that might help viewers solve the case.
And one of Britain's best-loved animations, how precious artwork from The Snowman flew away.
Hello, Charlie. You're the woman who lived in Brighton 2 years ago, and you've got some distinctive tattoos. Here's a picture of you taken in March 2001, though I have a feeling you won't be too pleased to see it. But 6 million other viewers will be keen. They'll want to know all about you.
Two flatmates, one of whom had dropped out of college, and one who at 17 had just left school.
It was a very mad lifestyle. You sort of concentrate getting on with your own life and having your own fun. Very caution to the wind of it. Living in Brighton, you have sort of just casual acquaintances, you know. So you do sort of just pick up friends here and there.
All right, Charlie?
Yeah, how are you?
Yeah, yeah,
good. This is my housemate, Tom. Tom, Charlie.
Hi, Tom. This is Nina.
All right. Right.
Do you guys want drinks?
Oh, yeah, sure. Another one of these would be nice.
Same again, thanks.
We first met Charlie in one of the clubs on the seafront. Charlie always seemed to have quite a bit of money on her. Always seemed quite confident.
Cheers! So, how's life been then?
Good! You know, work hard, play hard.
What is it you do anyway?
We work as waitresses. Top end of the market. You know, quality places.
What, down here?
No, we just come down to Brighton to go out.
Not long after, the boys ran into Charlie and Nina on another night out.
Why don't you come back to us for a bit? It's just a short walk.
All right, then. Have you got some more beers?
Yeah, loads of it.
Well, we might need to crash over, if that's all right.
No problems. You can kip ours if you want.
Yeah, it's not far. About 5 minutes. Yeah,
so they came back and gave him for some music on, had a couple of drinks. We didn't distrust her. We had no reason to.
Tell you what, this is a cool place. Is it just the two of you living here?
At the moment, yeah.
There was somebody else living here, but he's moved out. So now it's just the two of us until we find another flatmate. Where'd you get those tattoos done?
Oh, I've had them for a while. The ones on my arms are the names of my kids, and I've got my ex-husband's name on my back. So are you two looking for new housemates then?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, I'll have a think about it and I'll let you know if anyone comes to mind.
And then Charlie called a few days later.
Hello? Oh, hi, Charlie. Yeah, the room's still free. You would? Oh, that's excellent. No, that's really great. I'll see you then. Oi, that was Charlie. She's going to take the room.
Nice one.
Yeah, well, this is your new room.
It was a convenient arrangement for both of us, actually. She needed somewhere to stay, and we could have done with the rent. And she did spend a lot of her time out of the house. She was very rarely in. She wasn't actually there that long before this happened.
This is going to sound a bit weird, but is anything yours gone missing recently? I can't find my mobile anywhere, and I'm sure I left it in the house.
Are you sure you didn't take it out somewhere and leave it?
No, I definitely left it here, and now I can't find it anywhere. To be honest, I'm worried Charlie might have something to do with it. Maybe we should talk to her, see what she's got to say about it.
Yeah, well, fair enough. She hasn't paid this week's rent either, so I'll give her a call.
My intention was to try and sort it out as amicably as possible.
Charlie, it's Mark. Listen, you still haven't given us this week's rent.
Get it to us
any
time soon?
Oh, yeah, I'll come by tomorrow and pay it.
Cool. And there's something else?
Well, Tom and I have noticed that a couple of things have gone missing from the flat since you've moved in.
I just wanted to talk to you about it when you come round to pay the rent, OK?
I don't believe this. You can't accuse me of things like that. How dare you?
No. I'm not accusing you of anything. I just wanted to talk to you about it when you come round, OK?
You can't make accusations like that.
You should know better.
I'm going to get someone on to you.
Charlie, listen.
No, you listen.
Nobody talks to me like that. You're going to be kissing my feet in the morning. You hear me?
Didn't even cross our minds that, yeah, there'd be any consequences.
Who is it?
It's me, Charlie.
What do you want?
I've come to pay you your money and get my stuff.
I'm moving out.
Charlie, what are you doing?
I told you I'm moving out. I don't like being accused of stealing.
Is this the one?
But Charlie, what is all this?
You don't get away calling my sister a thief, right? Listen, yeah? By the time I finish you, they're going to need dental records to identify you. I'm going to chop you up, send you back to your mum in plastic bags. Don't call my sister a thief. Get back downstairs.
Just do what he says.
Where do you think you're going? Walk down the stairs, bloody, so I can see you. Right, mate?
You do fear for the worst. You think you're going to be killed. You don't know these people. You don't know what they're thinking. You don't know what they have done, what sort of situation they're in. So you do fear for the worst.
Take off your belts. Get down on the floor and look down. Look down. Don't move or I'll kill you. Take your belt off.
All right.
I don't know how many times they hit me. I don't know how many times they kicked me. And I was shaking. And I've never shaken like that before in my whole life. I think, to be perfectly honest, you don't get over something like this.
You move and I kill you.
All right.
Where's the money?
We don't have any money.
Come on, where's the money?
We don't have any money. There's about 50p in the whole house.
Just take anything you want.
What about their passports?
No, I need that.
Well, get their DVD player and the PlayStation.
It was very much like Charlie. He was directing everybody where things were. And that was generally her role in the robbery.
Do you know what? I'm gonna kill him, you know.
Don't be stupid. Get out.
You're lucky, boy. Look down, you're lucky.
You know, you really shouldn't upset Charlie. That's his sister. You're lucky to still be alive. You try and open that door in the next hour, I'll call the police. We'll come back and we'll kill you. And your family. All right?
It's all right.
I can't go out, have a good time with people that you don't know anymore.
As far as Bryce is concerned, I've left and never really came back. There's always that sort of stigma attached to it. It is always going to be there. It's always going to be part of my life. And no doubt I will carry on remembering it as clearly as I do now.
Well, let's talk to Detective Sergeant Mick Jones. Mick, we've got this photo of Charlie, as we can see here.
That's right.
What else do you know about him?
Very little. We aren't aware if Charlie is a real name or not. She's early 20s, 5'6" to 5'8". She has distinctive tattoos, one on the top of each arm, and underneath each tattoo is a name. One of those names we know is Callum. And she also has a tattoo on the base of her back, which has another name underneath, which she said was her ex-husband's name, who she said was a soldier in Aldershot.
Now, she said a few things about herself, didn't she? She said that she'd worked as a waitress. She said the tattoos were the names of her sons. And she claimed that the guy later on, or she didn't claim, but the guy who came in later on claimed that he was Charlie's brother. We just don't know if any of that's true, do we?
No, there could be a lot of misinformation there.
We were very careful to downplay the violence of that attack, but those boys were terrorised, weren't they?
That's right, they were only young boys. One had just turned 17 a couple of days earlier, and they were bound by their own belts and laying face down on the floor. And one of the offenders took a knife and cut open the rear of the 17-year-old's jeans and threatened to rape him. So he was obviously terrified, and it's had a profound effect on him since.
Well, we heard that as he was talking there in the film. What about Charlie? It's 2.5 years ago we're talking. That was in March 2001.
That's right.
So where is she now? Any ideas?
To be honest, we don't know where she is. So the appeal tonight is for anyone who recognises her photograph, who went to school with her, or anyone who was out in the pubs and clubs of Brighton on the seafront during that time, anyone who recognises her or can give us any information, to ring in and contact us.
OK, well, we've got a very good photograph. The tattoos are a very distinctive clue. There aren't going to be many people walking around with tattoos like that. It's a horrible, horrible attack. 0500 600 600 or the Instant Room on 01273 66 5542. Now, here's one of Mick's colleagues from the Sussex Force. In fact, he's your governor, isn't he? Detective Chief Superintendent Jeremy Payne, with some more faces you may recognise.
Take a look at these four. If you've seen them recently, you know where they are, then give us a call. Now, this is Alexander Hamish Brown, sometimes known by the nickname Eck. He failed to appear for his trial in June on a drugs conspiracy charge. He's got a strong Scottish accent, is co-director of a transport firm called Scotsweed. A qualified HGV driver, he has family in Perthshire and Blackburn. If you've seen him, then let us know. And Vincent Palmer, also known as Vinny, has been on the run for over 6 years. He escaped from Birmingham Crown Court in the middle of his trial for robbery and firearms offences. He's now wanted for murder. We know he's been in contact with friends in Birmingham and West Bromwich in the last few years, and he lived in Wednesbury for a while. Vincent Palmer uses a number of different names and alters his appearance to avoid being caught. He's 58, keeps fit and has a Birmingham accent. Have you seen him? Do you visit Chiswick or Hounslow in West London? Or Dover? If so, you may have seen this man, Hayman Mustafa. Now, he's wanted for murder and has been seen in all three places over the last month, but we don't know where he is now. He's an Iraqi Kurd with an athletic build and distinctive tattoos on both biceps, the letter H on his left arm and the letter D and a heart on his right. Now, we don't know if he's still got this trimmed pencil goatee beard. Hayman Mustafa is dangerous. Please don't approach him. Just call us instead.
And finally, this man, Cameron Khan, wanted for attempted murder. He's from Slough, but he's not been seen since June, when a man was shot outside a mosque. Now, he's got family in Birmingham and friends in Spain. And you might have spotted him on your holidays. He's 6'1", and when the photo was taken, he had short hair. His brown eyes have been described as piercing. Now, he also has a couple of tattoos, a crest on his right hand, the numbers 786 on his right forearm, and a Z-shaped scar on his left wrist. Now, if you recognise him or any of these faces, then please call us now.
Okay, now to a direct result of a Crimewatch reconstruction. A violent offender who handed himself in after a Crimewatch appeal. But it's an extraordinary case because he was prompted to confess by another Crimewatch reconstruction altogether. His name is Gregory Pierce.
You seen D.S. Merton?
I think it's upstairs.
Upstairs. Sarge? Can you come downstairs?
Can't it wait a minute?
I think you better come see this bloke. Says he raped an old lady last year. Don't think he's a crank. Seems genuine. He wants to confess.
All right, let's see what you got.
There are some crimes that even the most hardened criminals hate. This is one of them.
We decided to go to Crimewatch in the first place because all the inquiries we'd made at the initial reaction to the crime had pretty much drawn a blank, really.
As I said at the start, no one's going to defend a man who makes violent sex attacks on the elderly, which is what this was. And since there is that DNA evidence, suspects can easily be eliminated. As Aaron's just said, give us your suspicions. Someone aged late teens to early 20s who was in the High Wycombe area in mid to late September.
Afterwards, the lady at the police station, she rang me up and she said they'd had a lot of calls. Really a lot about that evening. So I thought, oh, maybe this is it, you know, maybe we get something.
I suppose, really, we'd hope that somebody would phone in with that one vital bit of information that would lead us to the offender, because quite clearly that was a very serious offence, and the sooner he was arrested, the better, really. So to get nothing substantial out of it was a bit disappointing.
So he's just handed himself in?
Says he saw himself on Crimewatch a year ago.
So why leave it till now?
He says he saw Crimewatch again the other night. That's made him hand himself in.
He looked like somebody that wanted to get something off his chest, that he was sort of on the verge of everything sort of coming pouring out.
Can you just repeat what you told the other officers?
I can't remember the exact date, but I tried to rape a woman about a year ago. I see it on Crimewatch, they described everything down to a T.
It took us a short while to work out what we thought he was talking about, but then it became fairly obvious that he was talking about the attack on the old lady in Chichester Close well over a year ago.
Why have you come to tell us now? I watched Crimewatch last Monday, and there was this black bloke raping all these old women. It was getting worse and worse, and I don't want the same to happen to me.
So you just want some help?
He said on Crimewatch you had DNA. Well, you can take my DNA if you want.
He always wears dark clothing, often an all-in-one boiler suit or tracksuit. The Crimewatch Gregory Pierce claimed to have seen a few days earlier had featured Operation Minstead, an appeal to find a man responsible for attacking elderly women over a 10-year period. Those crimes remain unsolved, but the reconstruction seems to have pricked Gregory Pierce's conscience. Not surprisingly, though, the detectives were sceptical at first.
Do you understand why you've been arrested, Gregory?
Yeah. Initially, there's always that possibility that someone's come in here and it's, you know, it's just too good to be true. People, for whatever reason, known to them, come in and want to admit to things that they haven't done.
I was walking home and I felt a bit aggressive, you know? I can remember picking up a broom handle and smashing in the window. I ran off. I went and sat on a bank looking down. And after a while, I staggered down there. And I leaned against the door and it opened. Next thing I know, I'm having a scuffle with this lady. Someone shouted, I panicked and I got up and I ran. I think I had a jumper tied around my waist. I remember that falling off as I ran.
As we were interviewing him and he was just pretty much reliving the Crimewatch reenactment, it did cause a little bit of concern that we had to be happy in our own mind that we were charging the right person and it wasn't just somebody that had watched the programme and come in and wanted a bit of attention for whatever misguided reason.
Simple, mate. It's not going to hurt at all. What I need you to do is open your mouth,
OK, it's only going to take a matter of seconds. What I'm going to do is just take one, two, three. Then we get this.
What's bothering me is that you said when you came in, you were worried that you'd seen Crime Watch, that you were going to turn into a serial rapist. Am I right in saying that?
No, I don't think you're right.
So what in the Crime Watch programme made you think I'm going to hand myself in when you didn't hand yourself in when you'd seen your crime a year before?
Because I could see similarities. Gaining entry, old people. Look, I've got a drugs problem and I've got an alcohol problem. But I like to think of myself as a fairly placid guy. I'm not violent. I've never sexually assaulted anyone.
Gregory Pierce never admitted to rape. His victim was so old and confused she was never able to tell police what he'd done. In June, he was found guilty of aggravated burglary with intent to rape and sentenced to 5 years.
Now, this case may have implications for another series of crimes, those Operation Minstead ones. It's a black man now in his 20s or 30s who's been assaulting elderly women in southeast London for a decade. I want to appeal to him directly. You know you're in the grip of a compulsion with at least 7 attacks in the last 2 months. They've been in Shirley, near Croydon and Orpington. That means you've now done terrible things to well over 80 people. Now, enough is enough. You know that. You've just seen Gregory Pierce, who's had the courage to come forward. Call us now and tell us who you are, or at least go to a police station tonight. You need help. You know you need help. Get help. 0500 600 600.
Other appeals we feature get sold independently of the programme. Here are a few of them. This is John Barber, a heroin trafficker, but this time he's not smuggling, he's being extradited from Spain. We'd shown his face on Crime Watch after he went missing during his trial. He'd gone on the run with a member of his own legal team. He was arrested on the Costa Brava following a police tip-off, and he's now serving 22 years in prison.
Gordon Johnston's a robber, and he's been on the run from prison since July. We need to get him back, as we're very worried that he may offend again.
He did. We later found out he'd robbed and attacked two elderly women. In the end, he was caught for driving a stolen car, and his other crimes caught up with him. Gordon Johnston is now back in prison, sentenced to 12 years.
2 years ago, Parvez Khan went on the run after knocking over and killing a man in Stafford. Several viewers called, but gave nothing that led to his arrest. Then detectives heard he was in Toronto. Canadian police arrested him and he was brought back to the UK, where he pleaded guilty. He's been sentenced to 5 years.
And a result, together with a reappeal. You may have heard about the recent convictions of three men who firebombed a house in Huddersfield, in which 8 people died, all from the same family, including 5 children. But West Yorkshire police are still looking for one other person in connection with the attack, and it's the same one we featured on Crime Watch back in February. If you know where Shahid Mohammed is, give us a call. 0500 600 600.
And after all that grim stuff, now a wonderful bit of fantasy. Nominated for an Oscar, The Snowman, the film based on the book by Raymond Briggs. It was released back in 1982, but it's become a Christmas classic, and in fact last year was its most successful one commercially so far. The film's almost 30 minutes long, and it's made up of more than 40,000 animated film cells, and they look, each of them, a bit like this. Obviously not normally framed, they're just see-through like this. Each one is individually handcrafted, and a few frames have been legitimately sold for up to about £1,200 each. But now, 22 cells like this have been stolen from the film's London production office. DS Gareth Codd of the Metropolitan Police is leading the investigation, and this is Roger Bainwood, who is one of the key animators on the film. And you must be pretty hacked off that these have been taken. Tell us about their significance.
Well, we are, because personally they meant a lot to us and the producers of the film.
And nationally, I think the snowman has a great deal of warmth in people's hearts.
Of course, it's still televised every Christmas, isn't it?
It is, yes, 20 years on.
Tell us about the frames that have been taken.
Well, here we see some of them. This is one as James has come back from the North Pole. And I was looking at them the other day, and I was amazed at the detail that we used to do in those days. If we go in close on the scarf, for example, you can see all the individual snowmen on the scarf, all with their hats on.
This was only on the film for a fraction of a second before it moved on to the next one, all before computer animation.
It was indeed, yes, all handcrafted. They took about an hour each to do, and the whole film took about a year to do. If we go on to the next one...
So 30 or 40,000 hours of work went into this?
That's right.
Drawing these.
This one is particularly nice because it's a nice composition. Not all cells make a nice picture that you can put on the wall, but this one does in particular. And then if we go on to the next one, which is at the snowman party at the North Pole, I was particularly amused by this because in the film you don't really notice it, but I see he has a nice glass of beer there, which is quite unusual for a children's film.
Yes, quite a lot was consumed at that party, I seem to remember. Gareth, what would the thieves now do with these things?
Well, certainly at this stage we can't rule out the possibility that they have been stolen to order. What's clear, though, is that whoever has taken them clearly knows the market and the industry and is probably looking to sell them on.
Now, if somebody has bought one of these in good faith, now, I did say some have been legitimately sold, but you know all about this. If someone's legitimately bought one, they think, but actually it's one of the stolen ones, what should they do?
They need to contact us. We can, if they have actually obtained it legitimately, we can ascertain that very quickly. If they haven't, they need to speak to us, and it could provide us with very real leads as to who has actually taken them in the first place.
So if you've seen one of these on somebody's wall, basically they should ring in, right?
Definitely. If they've got it legitimately, it's not a problem, and we'll be able to tell that very quickly.
OK, fine. Well, they're so distinctive. They are so lovely. If you know where those missing snowman cells are, or Lovell, who took them, call us now, 0500 600 600, or the instant room on 0208 733 6596.
The detection rate for murder is higher than most people imagine. In Scotland, where our next case is, it's over 99%. New techniques with DNA keep reviving the prospect of being caught. And tonight there's a chance of cracking one of Scotland's most notorious double murders in modern history. The killing of two teenage girls in Edinburgh back in 1977. Christine Eady and Helen Scott.
Well, Helen was just a normal teenager. She was, I would say, more of a tomboy than anything. If you saw Helen going out of the house, she was just about certain to be wearing jeans and a T-shirt.
Helen and Christine were both 17 and had been friends since they went to high school.
The killings of Helen and Christine are notorious in this area. I myself was a teenager just about to join the police, and I have vivid memories of how frightening this was for the general public at large here.
Right, where do you want to go now?
One Saturday after work in October 1977, Christine and Helen met up with friends and headed for the World's End pub in Edinburgh's Royal Mile.
Girls.
What can I get you?
Whiskey and lemonade?
Yeah.
Desperate for the loo, you come in.
Yeah. One of the friends who was there recalls the evening well.
I think there was a comment passed on the fact that this pub was called the World's End, and we thought, well, that's a good end to the night, the World's End.
I wonder who they are. Hey, look, there's Adrian.
What? There was a fella there that I knew that was from England, and I stood talking to him for a couple of minutes, and he happened to say, so he says,
"We're having a party later on, you fancy coming?"
"Yeah, sounds good."
"Excellent. Do you want a drink?"
And I said at the time, I said, like, Christine and Helen are with us. "That's all right," he says, "more the merrier." So we went back to go to tell Christine and Helen, and these two fellas were chatting to them.
"We're not interested in being picked up in pubs."
"Nah, we just want to take you for a dance."
"Dancing? I don't know about that."
"Everyone likes to have a dance. There's no harm in that."
Christine was sitting the other side and this chap was standing up, but she didn't seem to be too comfortable. It was pretty obvious that she didn't really want to be with this chap. She wasn't interested.
You've been invited to a party. Are you coming?
No, I'm just going to stay with Helen.
Are you all right?
No, I don't want to stay with him.
Come with us, then.
No, I'll stay with Helen.
All right, then. I'll see you later. Bye.
And so Jackie and myself left. And we left them in a pub, and that's the last time that we saw them.
Helen and Christine stayed till closing time and were noticed by two policemen. They also heard one of two men offering the girls a lift. But Helen and Christine went on walking down High Street, with two men still behind them.
It's strange to think that somewhere amongst these files, and these files contain about 13,000 statements that were taken back in 1977, the answer may lie. Statistics show that 92% of individuals who are subsequently caught for a retrospective case like this and are found to be guilty of murder are actually mentioned in the initial case papers. So the name could be in here. And that, linked with our DNA technology and the science that's helping us along with that, may just help us find the lock to that key of information we have.
First inkling I had that something was wrong was on the Sunday morning. I knew that Christine hadn't been back all night, but I just assumed that she'd stayed with Helen. And then I heard from Jackie, and she told me that Helen's mum and dad had been in touch with her to see if Helen was with her, because she hadn't been home all night. And I said, well, Christine has neither. And that's when I started to think, well, where are they?
Bruce!
Out of desperation, friends went out searching for Helen and Christine, even hunting open ground in Edinburgh, like Arthur's Seat. But the girls were no longer in the city. Later that Sunday, a couple walking in Gosford Bay found Christine.
Yeah, this is the A198 road. It's a coast road leading from Edinburgh to North Berwick. Christine's body was recovered at the high water mark just there. Quite a number of footprints round about her body. She was naked, she had been bound, she'd been brutally beaten, we know that, and later on we found that she'd been sexually assaulted as well.
Helen's body was found several miles away in farmland near Haddington.
This is the corn stubble field where Helen's body was discovered. She was found partially clothed. The base of her feet had mud marks on it, which gave us the impression that she may have been led in here and actually killed in the field. Like Christine, she was viciously assaulted and also sexually assaulted as well. If we look into the distance in the coastline about 6 miles away, that's where Christine's body was found. It's a fairly isolated rural location, and it would give us the impression that it's somebody who is used to the area or has knowledge of the area in order to be able to navigate themselves here.
I think it was about 8, 9, 10 o'clock, I think, when before they brought Helen back to the mortuary. I was the only person that ever saw her after that. I know her mum wanted to go and things, and I said no. I said, I prefer you remember Helen as you saw her that morning, going out the door. I want to see it resolved. It's got to be resolved.
Well, D.I. Alan Jones, we saw him in the film there, he's here now. It's over a quarter century old, this case. Why now? Why come to Crime Watch now?
Yeah. We currently have the DNA profile of a man who we believe is connected to the murders of both Helen and Christine. What we hope to do at this phase is widen our search for him and perhaps identify him through his family. That's the main thrust of what we're doing at present.
And this is a new development in DNA,
isn't it? A new development.
It?
It's called familial searching. So hopefully we'll be able to exploit that new technology.
It seems amazing that, you know, after 26 years, you had these two blokes in the pub. They've got to be prime suspects, and yet still so little is known about them.
Yeah, you're right, they are prime suspects. Not a great deal is known about them. We know that we're in the mid-20s. We know that one of them was particularly unfashionably dressed, which is various witnesses commented
on. Because it certainly stood out. We actually had, let me just get them here, we had a pair of trousers with someone who was in the pub
Someone who was in the pub there described them. So we had these made up, especially for the reconstruction, these pinstripe trousers with these studs on. And they stood out because, well, because they kind of stood out. They're unfashionable and...
Definitely, even for that time, they stood out. Now, we know that both these men had Scottish accents as well, so potentially...
Edinburgh accents, could anyone tell?
Local, you know, they suggested it may have been county, which would suggest that further out into East Lothian, Mid Lothian area, but certainly Scottish accents.
And maybe what now, in the early 50s?
Early 50s, were the late 20s at that time, so, yeah, early 50s.
Now, you've got DNA of one man linked to, and the same man linked both Helen and Christine. Is it likely that the two men were involved in both these attacks?
We're unable to say. That's the mystery of it. We only have the one profile of one offender. It may be that one man was more passive in events and didn't take the same degree of involvement in the murders.
Or he may not have been involved at all.
Or may not be involved at all. If that's the case, we want to appeal to that person to come forward. Many years have now passed, loyalties change. We would hope that individual would help us resolve the case.
When Christine and Helen were found, Helen had some of her clothes with her, but Christine had no clothes with her, she had no personal effects, and they still haven't been found. We've got this here, this cigarette lighter, silver, with... it's got a Donny on, why is that?
Yeah, she was a keen fan of the Osmonds at the time,
and that
relates to Donny Osmond.
And so this has never been found. And also, we've got a coat here that's very similar to the one she was wearing. And again, as I say, nothing of Christine's been found, and certainly not this coat.
Yeah, very distinctive again. It was a woolen coat with this fake fur collar. Rather much bluer than that coat is, but again, very distinctive for the time.
So if anyone's seen any of those items, anything, it's 26 years now, if you know anything about those two men, if you're one of those men, you were saying that someone came forward with new evidence just yesterday. So even though it's been over a quarter of a century, if you know anything, give us a call, 0500 600 600, or the Instant Room on 0131 311 3777.
I can tell you so many people are trying to help tonight. The attempted rape in Doncaster, well, that was remarkable footage. Remember on the CCTV of the man trying to abduct a girl? We've got all sorts of stuff. One man has been identified by someone who knows him very, very well. It's described as a very, very strong lead. And if that doesn't work, we've got two people quite independently given the same name. On the Brighton flat attack, remember this girl, Charlie? Well, it turns out from lots of callers that that is her real name. People have given us a whole bunch of background about her. Some guy said she was in Brighton very recently and may still be there for all we know. We've got all sorts of links to Aldershot, and we know a great deal about her now, including an address for one of her accomplices. So that looks very good indeed. On the Leonardo da Vinci, we have, well, high excitement earlier. I must say I'm rather more cautious about that. We'll tell you about that later on, though. Now, all our numbers are on CFAX on page 621. Don't forget, you can see a reminder of some of tonight's cases, plus crime prevention advice and a great deal more on our website, bbc.co.uk/crime. If you've been a victim of crime, you can call Victim Support Line. That's on 0845 30 3900.
And our phone lines are open until midnight tonight and tomorrow from 7:30 in the morning until midnight. We'll be back later than usual at 11:15 with the Crime Watch update.
If 11:15 is after your bedtime, don't have nightmares, do sleep well. Good night.
Good night.